Yeah, in the chat, I agree. Losing on time when your opponent has 5 minutes left is kind of luck of the draw. Losing on time when your opponent has 20 minutes left is on you. Gotta play faster. But unlike some other instances we've seen in the past, nobody was really mad about it. As soon as Jeff timed out, he immediately congratulated Nick, and that was it. And there was no drama. That's a good thing. So congrats to both of those guys. Looked like they were both playing very well. So we're gonna have at 1 o'clock, as soon as the game gets started, we're gonna have Timo Dusel versus Matt Lutz. That's Dylan versus CRG. So if you are in, yeah, so that is in the Chris Kelly bracket. They are the 4 seed and the 5 seed, and they will be facing off in round 2, which begins momentarily. The winner of that game will face the winner of Chris Kelly and Rich Kraft. So the first round is all completed. And just glancing down through, so in the 8-9 games, we had 2 8s won and 2 9s won. But in the 7-10 games, 1 7 won and 3 10s. But I'm just trying to look through here. In all the other matchups, I believe, in all like the 6-11s, the 5-12s, all that stuff, no upsets. So the first round was all chalk, except for 3 10 seeds and 2 9 seeds, which I think is it's a testament to, perhaps some of those 10 seeds being underrated, perhaps some really strong and innovative deck choices, but also, as we've seen before, the chalkiness of the first couple of rounds is really a testament to the folks who make the bracket, and they do a great job, and yeah. All right. Is this getting started anytime soon? Looks like we're about ready. All right. So Timo is going to be playing dark first. Matt's going to be playing light first. Timo being the higher seed, the 4 seed, he gets to pick which deck he plays first. And we've got this deal's getting worse all the time. Versus profit. Interesting. Not sure how interactive this matchup is going to be. I think the recent builds I've seen of Dark Deal are sort of like IE ported onto Dark Deal, so you can still play Admiral's Orders. So instead of starting with your ship, you just get your ship for free on turn one. And you same thing, you set up, Piet on the Executor, and he gets your Admiral's Order, and they starts pulling vehicles, and you get your celebration, and that's the way I've seen it played recently, at least, since the IE errata. And I've seen CRG or Matt Lutz play a few different interesting profits. We'll see what kind of this is. We've got an early Mandalorian mishap for Han's Heavy Blaster Pistol V, which is the very cool virtual blaster pistol that can either protect Han, like go use to cancel a weapon destiny targeting Han, or if it stays on Han, it can just shoot dudes during the control phase, which is always a good time. It's like a built-in, sorry about the mess. So I'm sure that once Matt frees Han, he'll want to put that gun on him. He is starting solo as his Han of choice, not the one that makes the retrieval immune to secret plans, but he's starting solo, which indicates to me that Lor San Tekka is in this deck, and he's going to be using Lor San Tekka and Han's Heavy Blaster Pistol to, like, scoot Han over during the control phase, and then during the control phase shoot the gun using the gun zone text, and just pick guys off during the control phase all over the planet that way. Which is a very fun concept that I've seen executed really well by a few different players, and Matt Lutz is one of them. So let's see how this goes. I'm not sure how interactive a matchup this is going to be, but I do know that this Dark Deal deck, or it's not actually a Dark Deal deck. I don't think it deploys Dark Deal, but this deal is getting worse all the time. Deck certainly can put on the pressure with damage. Yeah, Belugo says he shot my dudes a bunch with that blaster. This, if this is the Prophet deck, I think it is. It is based on a deck Tom Hayde played maybe at the MPC 3 years ago. And I remember, playing some very aggravating games against Tom when he was developing that deck. And he brought it to the MPC and aggravated everybody there with it. He calls it Peaceful Prophet, and the idea of it is to just never battle. And if they battle, you always have a way to cancel it or get out of the battle. And the idea is to just spread out and do ping damage with good blaster, with the Prophet objective, with BB-8, retrieve with Rose, R3PO pings if they have spies. You just do all of that damage, and you shoot guys during the control phase, and that's kind of the deck. And it does a deceptively large amount of damage, all without really having to risk being in bad battles, because it uses Caldera Rigim, it uses fire extinguishers, it's a trap, all kinds of stuff to just stop battles from happening so that you can just keep doing your ping damage and keep shooting guys in the control phase. Yeah, I agree. He should set up occupation soon. The nice thing about this deal objective is that it pulls occupation for you. Right there. It can take it into hand during your deploy phase. So he sets up the executor by itself, which is probably a fine move against Prophet. You don't expect Prophet to be going to space. Then Piet at the docking bay. And we've got Ozzel on a walker at the downtown plaza. That's not a bad turn one for any deck. And then, so next turn, I'm sure he will get the Cloud City Docking Bay out, get another walker out, Docking Bay Transit Piet over, get Occupation going. So CRG here is going to play his Rendezvous Point on Tatooine. This is the starting interrupt that goes into your hand and then lets you download a Tatooine Battleground. And he's going to get the Jabba's Palace Antechamber. Yeah. Force loss of 6 a turn with once occupation is set up, but like probably more than that, I would think. Because you've got the Cloud City Docking Bay in there. That's 1-1 and 2 at the three sites. So that's 4. 1 at the system is 5, and then 3 from occupation is 8. If you have Chirino, that's 9. It's a lot of damage for Prophet to try to race. But it's doable. Yeah, will be interesting to see if Matt has ship and landing claw or no space at all. I don't know. I don't know exactly what his build looks like or how it compares to Tom's original build from, 3 years ago when a lot of these cards looked a little different. But I know Tom was playing a ship and a landing claw, and I have no idea whether Matt is. Certainly, I think his space package is either nothing or one ship and one landing claw. So a ship and landing claw in your game with him earlier. Okay. That could potentially be pretty big. Just in addition to blocking the Bespin drain, it would also turn on drains of about, 3 or 4 on the ground on Tatooine. And when you combine that with the Prophet damage and the good blaster damage and BB-8 and all that other stuff, now you're talking about actually surviving in this race. Alright, so Dylan's going to get another combat vehicle. We've got Blizzard Scout 1, which is my personal favorite of all the chicken walkers. I just love, it's a random AT-ST, it reacts, and then it's like, oh no, psych, I deploy an AT-AT, and now all of a sudden I cancel Yoda's game text, because walkers are just stupid good. Alright, so no Cloud City docking bay yet. I wonder if it got stuck in at the bottom of Force Pile, or if it's in hand and he's just waiting for the opportune moment. I think it's definitely in the deck. I don't think you deploy Piet to the Executor docking bay without having the Cloud City docking bay for him to go to. But for the moment, you'll take the three extra, or the three force generation from mobilization points. Oh, Dylan helpfully letting everybody on the stream know that there are two free rides in Matt's deck. And he's joking around and saying, come on, Matt. But, this version of this deal's getting worse all the time has been around for a little while. And especially if you have a light deck that's not particularly interactive or can't interact with walkers well. If you're the kind of deck that used to be concerned about IE, you're smart to be concerned about this now, because this seems to be one of the new things. So I think double free ride if you're expecting this kind of deck. Smart choice. And against everything else, it's just a free cycling five. Alright, we've got a control tunnel vision from Matt to get all of his combo pieces set up. Oh, and I think, yeah, we already saw one free ride. Must have missed that. So it must mean there's another one. There's a Cloud City occupation in the lost pile. Okay. So Yoxgit's gonna come down and just free Han. Yeah, and then Han played the control tunnel vision from Lost Pile, that got other stuff. And yeah, again, he's gonna forego the retrieval of five. You need that five force for other things at this stage of the game. And you want to free Han as quickly as possible. Alright, so Radiant 7's gonna get barriered. But I think it is almost certainly going to get a landing claw here. Yeah. And that is a Yoxgit non-virtual. So if the landing claw gets canceled by those Rebels Won't Escape Us or Captain Goddard, Yoxgit's just going to get it right back for 3-force. Unless there is a deflector shield generator, this landing claw is always going to be in effect. Unless Matt really messes up and lets Yoxkit die, which I promise won't happen. Yeah, a lot of fire extinguishers. Yeah, that's another thing the deck does, that if you're trying to fight on the ground, R2 and a fire extinguisher, it'll just send the fire extinguisher lost to cancel the battle. And then on Lightside's turn, Yoxkit just pays 3 to get the fire extinguisher back, puts it back on R2. Okay, so Timo's going to come down to Tatooine now with Blizzard 4, and it's going to download Sergeant Eyeroll, who doesn't really do anything, but I believe Drellison is the guy who adds a Battle Destiny with him. Yep, and there he is. Corporal Drellison, when in battle with Eyeroll, out of sight, adds a Battle Destiny. Alright, so Timo trying to go as wide as he can right away. He's really, I think, counting on his reacting going through at some of these sites, like Oslo by himself, Blizzard Scout 1 by itself, but if he can get those reacts off, it'll all be okay. Yep. And Yuxkit is going to get back Anakin's lightsaber, non-virtual. Alright, and there's BB-8. That'll add one more damage. And I think he's just gonna check his deck. Make sure he knows what's in there. Probably so he can do a seeking pull? Alright, so Matt's going to use Walkling now to get a gift back into his life force. Alright, and there's the other free ride to cancel the other occupation. Alright, but this is still 8 damage coming his way from Timo. Ooh, alright. We've got a could be worse to reduce a drain by 2, and then Tarkin's orders to cancel the could be worse. And those biker scouts do count as stormtroopers, so they will drain for 2 at the farm. It'll be 9 damage total. Alright, we're back. Don't know why that happened. We are still in Timo's drains. Matt is still losing force. Looks like Timo is just going to take the opportunity to reinforce his pretty dominant position. So Matt's going to take 8 damage that turn, plus he has his could be worse canceled. Not the kind of turn you can have a lot of if you want to have success here. He's going to need to find some answers for all of that damage. But despite all of that, the hand and life force counts are equal right now. Alright, so he's got a drain of 1, a profit ping, and a BB-8 ping at the audience chamber. 3 damage is not as much as Timo is doing, but it's still nothing to sneeze at. And there's good blaster. So even without doing anything else, that ups it to 4 damage a turn. 1 from profit, 1 from good blaster, 1 from BB-8, and the drain of 1. There's a Baragwin. A And what that'll do is it'll just pitch excess fire extinguishers to drains, and then once per turn, you can just immediately retrieve them. And then you lose them to another drain at the end of the turn. You know, the last drain of the turn. So that when it's the beginning of your turn, that green card is still on top, and the Bargwin just gets it back again. Alright, and there's Lorsan Tekka. There's 3PO coming over with a gift. All right. Sorry about that. I muted the audio for a second because I needed to go to the bathroom. No, I'm still awake. Plenty of caffeine. But no, I mean, Coward wouldn't really, I mean, I understand why he pulled it, just in case there's retrieval, but it's not going to do anything to stop the damage. Or the retrieval, to be honest. Like, he doesn't have Rose right now, but if he did, all he has to do is Lorsan Tekka over, you know, somebody to the antechamber during control phase, then do all his pinging and retrieving, and then move guys over to consolidate them. And I think Matt is probably kicking himself right now for pitching those projections to force drains. I think he'd probably really like to have them to just put on his own Jabba's palace and his own farm right about now. So there's the one ping from Good Blaster, the one from BB-8. And now I think you're going to see Lorsanteca move Han over. Yep. Yeah, and he's going to go over to the antechamber. So now there's going to be a profit ping for two, and then drains of one and one. Yeah, Stimpy, why Matt thought it was important to get back a gift. I had assumed he was going to move 3PO out to Jabba's palace to block the drain of two. That ended up not happening, and I'm not sure why. Maybe he's waiting until he can grab Trample and play perimeter scan. Like, maybe he doesn't have the perimeter scan yet. But, yeah, I think blocking a drain is the only thing that it can do for you in this matchup. But, like, I think it's a very strong play to just grab the trample and then play perimeter scan. And then, you know. No, his gun cannot shoot a vehicle. If it could, he would have gone there, I promise you. But, I mean, at least, you know, so far, CRG is doing a decent job keeping this a close game. Despite, you know, getting drained for two at a couple of his own sites. Yep, and he's just going to use a whole bunch of force to move absolutely everybody over. Except I don't think you need to move BB-8 over. Yeah, but he does anyway. And yeah, I mean, I think CRG's doing fine. I was just gonna say it's a little disappointing that he hasn't found another gun yet. But you know, he also just searched 10 out of the 11 cards in his deck, and there wasn't another gun. So I don't know if stuff just got peeled early, or if he's got it in hand. But yeah, I mean, another gun for that extra good blaster ping would be very handy, although I guess you don't really care about that because of decree. Yeah, and that's the other thing the Prophet deck does really well is just the damage mitigation. Alright, so that we're doomed ends up saving Matt a lot of force loss. Vader, Emperor's Enforcer comes down. The thing about that is, like, I'm not sure exactly what 3PO just put down, but I'm guessing it's a high destiny card. And, I mean, Solo is just gonna scoot over with Lor San Tekka and shoot Vader during the control phase at plus two. And actually, now that the biker scouts are there too, I mean, you scoot Solo over, shoot one of the bikers, and then just, you know, well, I guess Caldera doesn't work because Vader just cancels his text. But yeah, I mean, shoot Vader. And then if they try to battle you back, fire extinguisher. So the Radiant 7 will detach. That's the good blaster ping, BB-8 ping. Drain of 1. And the profit ping is coming. Gonna move Solo over first. Yep. Yep. And Vader's toast. And that one remaining card in reserve deck is the word doomed. So he's gonna 3PO into that at his leisure. Matt very studiously avoiding the trample. Yeah, well, there has not been a battle so far. That's one of the frustrating things about this Prophet deck is, you know, I mean, the Dark Deal deck is not particularly interactive with a deck like Prophet. It's just kind of a damage race, but even when you have a dark deck that's trying to be interactive, this Prophet deck just doesn't let you. It'll just fire extinguisher, or it's a trap every battle, and just do a whole bunch of damage to you. Yep. And there's the control tunnel vision, and we're doomed. To reduce the entirety of the dark side's damage down to about 3. Alright, so Darkseid's gonna try a battle at the audience chamber. And we're just gonna have it be fire extinguishered. No battle for you. What Timo needs to decide now is, you know, I think he really needs to take those two biker scouts and move them out to Jabba's palace and get back on the walker. Because if they stay indoors, Han is going to shoot one of them during the control phase, and then there actually is going to be a battle. Maybe. But it looks like he's just going to walk Barrich in instead. So 11 hand and life force for Dylan, and 12 hand and life force for CRG. we'll shoot Drellison. He's gone. And we'll scoot away so he can do a good blaster ping and a BB-8 ping. And the fire extinguisher comes back. I think you just move Lorsanteca over. Yep. Yeah, Harkchef Non-V is a really good card in here. Yep, and there goes Lore. Yep, another battle, another fire extinguisher. All right. Coming down the home stretch now. So we're going to have a BB-8 ping, a blaster ping, a profit ping, and a drain of 1, which will be 4 total damage. Han will move over and shoot a trooper. And the fire extinguisher is coming back. I think. Yeah, I'm not sure why he saved 3 force. Okay. He's going to Barguin the fire extinguisher instead. Yep. And there goes Barrich. And now we might see a battle. Yep. Look at that. Light side initiated a battle. Yep. And Sergeant Eyeroll is going to get shot by Han's blaster. Timo's going to take a card off the Sandy effect. Which is a sneak attack that he's going to use to add a battle destiny. Got a 5 and a 5. So 13 to 7. And if that one card in hand is a Gick, then we play on. Yep. Forfeit Hark. Ooh, and it looks like we do not have a Gick. So that is the game. And Matt wins by 8. All right, looks like they're going to take about a 5-minute break before game two. And when they're ready to get started, we will be ready too.